To the seventh meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy in what is our final pre-budget scrutiny session. Unfortunately, the Cabinet Secretary is unable to be with us in person as she recently tested positive for COVID-19. Hope she's recovering well and hasn't been too badly affected by the virus. Members have received a paper from the clerks, along with private briefings from our budget advisor and from the Financial Scrutiny Unit in Spice. I therefore welcome to the meeting Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy. And Ms Forbes is today joined by Scottish Government officials Dougie McLaren, Deputy Director, Budget, Pay and Pensions, and Clay McManus, Fiscal Framework Team Leader. I intend to allow 90 minutes for this session, but before we open up to questions from the committee, I invite Ms Forbes to make a short opening statement. Kate.
Thank you, Convener, for the invitation to join you today. And I'm sorry once again not to be with you in person. I hope the committee is not starting to draw any conclusions that I seem to only self-isolate when I have a finance committee session. But thank you also for your engagement around the budget timetable to date. And Convener, I know you asked for very brief opening remarks, but I wonder if I could set out just some comments that would be helpful in the committee's scrutiny. I'm very grateful that on agreeing 9th of December, we've duly balanced the time for developing our proposals for the budget with the due time for scrutiny. As ever, and the committee will know this, our position is contingent on our settlement from Treasury on the 27th of October. But at the very least, this year, we should have firmer and fuller information than for our previous two budget processes. The timing of the UK spending review and the autumn budget seems to be a return to the pre-Brexit and pre-COVID cycle, though I don't have any insights yet into whether that means the Treasury plans an update in the spring. With this budget, the fiscal framework and the wider devolution settlement will continue to be tested, with the related volatilities having increased, but the levers and the flexibilities remaining constrained. And that applies as much to our in-year management, with the UK government repeatedly indicating consequential funding of, and I quote, up to a provisional amount that is subject to confirmation later in the year, by which time the moment has often passed or the need for that funding has passed. So as I always say, additional funding is generally welcome when it comes, but the arrangements for confirming it, and that's what I wanted to emphasise, the arrangements for confirming the funding generally fall well short of what is required, especially during a real-time pandemic response. So I'll continue to engage positively with the UK government as we recover from COVID. And I had an initial meeting with the new Chief Secretary last month, and I'm due to attend a finance quadrilateral in the coming days focused on the spending review. We'll, of course, take our strategic lead from the programme for government, and the budget will reflect and fund the government's priorities. As indicated in our recent correspondence, we're also continuing preparatory work in respect of a multi-year resource spending review, and we plan to publish a framework for consultation around the time of the budget. Finally, I'm also pleased to cover any questions the committee may have on the Fiscal Framework Outturn Report, and that publication fulfils the government's commitment to transparency in the operation of the Fiscal Framework, providing the Parliament with information to support its scrutiny. The report shows a total provisional reconciliation of negative £14.8 million that will apply to the 2022-23 Scottish Budget, with final reconciliation confirmed once final outturn data is published later this year. Thank you, Convener, and I look forward to the committee's questions.
Thank you very much for that opening statement. And in time-honoured fashion, I'll start with some questions, then we'll go around the table. So we received as a committee some 46 submissions to our call for evidence, and the Cabinet Secretary will not be surprised to learn that amongst those were myriad calls for additional expenditure, but the same organisations were much more coy about exactly how much they were calling for and indeed from whom the Scottish Government would or should ask to pay for additional expenditure. And often the benefits that were provided in response to questions were that the benefits would be long-term but the costs would be much more immediate. We've also had Labour politicians seeking a quadrupling of the child payment at a cost of £272 million a year, and Conservatives suggesting that the Scottish Government could, if it so wished, pick up the tab for the £20 a week cut in universal credit at a cost of £461 million a year. So the simple question I want to start off with is, how much room does the Scottish Government have for manoeuvre, and what is its priorities in the forthcoming year?
Thanks, Convener. And this is a really important context-setting question, because as I look ahead, and I said this at the last committee hearing, next year's budget, it feels like one of the most challenging in devolution. Now, I think every finance secretary has said that since the beginning of devolution. But next year's is particularly challenging for three reasons. Firstly, because the costs of mitigating COVID continue with the associated volatility and uncertainty, and therefore we need to manage that, for example, when it comes to self-isolation payments or when it comes to the NHS. But secondly, we're trying to remobilise all our public services. So remobilising the health service, remobilising social care, remobilising the justice system, economic recovery, all require financial support. But over and above that, the final challenge is the funding settlement that we are receiving, because obviously there was significantly less, but there still was COVID consequentials this year. I think it highly unlikely that we will see that additional funding from the UK government to deal with those additional pressures. And indeed, we're already seeing the UK government pulling back quite significantly, for example, with the removal of the £20 a week uplift and the end of furlough and so on and so on. So I think all in all, the costs and the need are going to continue, but the funding available to us is going to significantly decrease. And in that you asked, well, what is the Scottish Government's priorities? And our priorities are set out in the programme for government. And they are quite simply to continue to support families in need who are dealing with the consequences of COVID, as well as dealing with some of the inequalities that have been exacerbated by COVID, but also to remobilise our public services and to drive economic recovery. Those are our three main areas. Just briefly, you talked about the Scottish Child Payment. The First Minister has said in the programme for government that we will double the Scottish Child Payment to £20 as soon as possible, and we will outline plans in the budget for how we will do that.
Thank you very much. I'm so tempted to come back on that last one, but I'm going to actually move on, because there's a number of issues I want to kind of like touch on so that colleagues can perhaps expand on those. And one of the things that we often get at committee, and indeed we received it this year, was suggestions that more flexibility is provided to, for example, local government to raise revenue on its own. Has the Scottish Government identified additional revenue streams either that it itself could adopt or indeed could be devolved down to local government? And will it encourage local government and others to develop their own revenue streams given the financial situation we're currently in?
So, as you can imagine, local government over the last few years in particular has looked quite extensively at income, ways of generating income. Now, for the most part, local authorities have developed their own schemes, and we saw that impact acutely during COVID, where some local authorities were more exposed to income reduction than others. So you'll recall that I put in place funding to cover the fact that some local authorities were no longer generating income during COVID. So local authorities have done that. In terms of additional taxation powers, we obviously, prior to the pandemic, were in discussion with local government about a number of different local taxes, including the tourism levy, which different members in Parliament and beyond have different views on. But we were looking at the most comprehensive devolution of additional tax raising powers to local authorities since the advent of devolution. COVID has put a stop to some of that temporarily. But when it comes to additional fiscal flexibilities, I am very sympathetic to additional fiscal flexibilities for local government. I think that in calling for fiscal flexibilities for the Scottish Government, I think it's only right that those are passed on to local authorities. And we did manage to secure some temporary additional fiscal flexibilities for local government. In fact, we were more successful in securing temporary fiscal flexibilities for local government during the pandemic with the support of Treasury than we were for ourselves. So very happy to continue to explore with local government what additional powers they need. I think I would stress, though, that different authorities have a different balance of income that comes from either different taxes, other fees or charges or income, or from the local from Scottish Government. And I think that's how it should be, that local authorities are themselves able to tailor their income generation approach to local circumstances.
Okay, now obviously significant multi-billion pounds of consequentials has been received from the UK government since the start of the pandemic. How much of this is still available to allocate, and is there any risk potentially of a clawback? And moving on from that, in terms of the UK Health and Social Care Levy, has there been a guarantee of consequentials and when they will be delivered?
Thanks. This is a really important question again, because last year we obviously had a guarantee. So where money was announced, it was guaranteed to come. But prior to the pandemic, the way in which the UK government funds the Scottish government is to make announcements and then to confirm that funding at key points in the financial year. In terms of our funding position, we have allocated £980 million of the £1 billion of COVID consequentials in the budget revision, which I imagine you will take evidence on over the next month. The Minister for Public Finance will lead on that. On top of that, we have drawn down £168 million of balances from the Scotland Reserve to support the health service and farming in particular. And the balance left for formal allocation following this budget revision, which you'll take evidence on, is £328 million, of which £250 million relates to capital and financial transactions that are being deployed again across a range of pressures for capital budgets like health, transport, energy and education. And there's obviously a difference between funding that is allocated formally through the budget revision and our ongoing budget management internally in the Scottish Government. So every single penny has been earmarked or has been allocated. It is supporting our in-year budget position. But where we have not formally allocated funding, we will do so once we've had the reassurances from the UK Government at the supplementary estimate. So in short, I cannot confidently allocate every penny without the Barnett guarantee until that funding has been formally guaranteed for me by the UK government. And we expect Treasury to provide an update on additional funding for 21-22 alongside the spending review in late October. And often that formal confirmation from the UK government happens in the days after the spending review, and we will be in discussion with them to get that formal confirmation of our spending so that we can then ensure that the Parliament, through the budget revision, has a formal allocation of every penny.
Now, I'm just going to ask you a couple of questions on the impact on economic growth of a couple of issues which are very prominent in news at the moment. In fact, I saw the Prime Minister answer questions on these just in the news this morning, which is skill shortages, and we had quite a significant discussion on that in the hour prior to this meeting with our budget advisor. So skill shortages are acute in many sectors, and there's huge divergence across Scotland, as I think we acknowledge. So what additional resources will the Scottish Government invest in addressing those shortages, and which sectors are being prioritised? And is there a specific focus on geographic areas of the economy? Because in some areas there is a surplus labour pool, whereas in others there is a chronic shortage. And there's always a question, I suppose, in economics of, do you move the people to the jobs or the jobs to the people? So what's the Scottish Government's view of that, given the fact that when we look at the demographic future of Scotland, even over the next decade, some local authorities will have significant population growth, you know, from, for example, an 8% projected growth for Midlothian, but a 4% reduction in the Western Isles. So what's the Scottish Government's approach to that key issue?
Thanks. And I should say at the outset that we, of course, track Scotland's economic performance very closely because of the implications it has for not only our revenue position, but also because it's important that we track our performance in relation to the rest of the UK because of the operation of the fiscal framework. And although Scotland's GDP is still obviously below pre-pandemic levels, it is gradually recovering, and it's continuing to broadly track the UK as a whole. But as you said, Convener, the pace of recovery is not just different across different geographies, but it's also different across sectors. And quite clearly, some sectors are more exposed to the bottlenecks in supply chains and recruitment. If you take food and drink, for example, a particularly important Scottish industry, it's facing severe challenges with rising prices and labour market shortages. So in terms of what the Scottish Government can do, we obviously stand ready to do whatever we need to do and can do. And that includes close engagement with the UK government. Richard Lochhead is leading on the labour market shortages, working very closely hand in glove with industry to try and intervene where we can. And one of our most obvious interventions is around the skills system. But what I would strongly emphasise is that I don't believe that these shortages and challenges can in any way be resolved through the Scottish Government's budget alone. We have a role to play. We play that role we take our responsibility seriously. But when it comes to labour market shortages, it's well documented that the acute shortages that we are facing right now are largely to do with immigration policy, over which we have no control. So we can intervene. Some of those interventions may look small, but we are doing what we can. For example, funding a marketing campaign in the hospitality industry to try and recruit more people. But I'm sure the industry will say that is small fry compared to what they really need, which is the ability to access visas and bring in far more people to work in these sectors. And the same goes with supply chains. We engage closely. I have regular meetings with UK government counterparts, not least on some of the challenges around gas prices and when we had the CO2 shortage, which has been temporarily fixed or resolved, but not resolved for the long term. And these are our acute issues. But I guess what I'm trying to say is where we can intervene, we absolutely will. But I don't think anybody is suggesting that the Scottish Government can resolve it. And certainly from our budget perspective, these issues are much bigger than just financial support. I think financial support will only go so far.
Well, immigration is obviously one factor, but surely we have to do more to upskill, you know, the 4 to 5% of the population that we actually have who are currently unemployed, particularly at a time when there's a huge number of vacancies in the economy. And I think that's an issue I'd be keen for the Scottish Government to address more. But gas you touched on, and the Scottish Government has a national collaborative framework for the supply of natural gas, and that means that there's been no increase in wholesale of cost of gas since April 2021, and there will not be during this financial year. But I'm just wondering what the impact is likely to be on the Scottish Government next year, because obviously that, I imagine, will have to be renegotiated in view of prices and will have a significant impact on the Scottish Government. And secondly, the impact on the private sector, particularly fuel-intensive industries. I've got a number in my own constituency, I'm sure colleagues do too. So what, if anything, can the Scottish Government do to try and assist with that particular issue at this time?
Yeah, I guess you talked about the reskilling that's required and absolutely vital and important. It will not help in the short term, but we do need to ensure that, that the money is going to the people that, that most need it. In terms of energy costs and fuel shortages, we again engage closely with industry. But I guess the big tool I have at my disposal right now that I'm giving you evidence on is on budget. And industry repeatedly are telling us that they're not looking for necessarily financial support. They want to be able to trade. The economy is recovering. Trade is available. Markets are there, but they cannot meet demand. So the difficulty is supply, not demand. And when it comes to prices, when it comes to energy costs, when it comes to shortages, in our close engagement with industry, they are repeatedly telling us that the resolutions to that, the solutions to that, don't lie with financial grants necessarily. They lie with being able, with enabling them to access what they need, which is adequate and affordable supplies. So when it comes to what we can do, we will repeatedly engage with the UK government. But I certainly don't have a currently unallocated budget this year to meet the shortages in fuel, because we just don't have either consequential funding for that, nor do we have any headroom to provide additional financial support.
Okay, thank you. Just a couple more questions from me, and then we'll open out to the committee. And the first of these two questions is what the level of engagement has been with the UK government prior to announcing that it will set out a multi-year spending review, given the impact this will have on Scotland's finances.
So I'm very hopeful that I will be able to build a very constructive relationship with the new Chief Secretary. I had a good first conversation with him just over a week ago, and I'm due to see him on the 14th of October for a quadrilateral on the spending review. So I perhaps will be able to answer that question better after that meeting on the 14th of October. And I'm very happy to provide the Finance Committee with a rough outline and update of how that meeting goes.
Thank you. And I was very pleased that you invited myself, the Deputy Convener and the Convener of Social Security to a meeting last week to discuss issues around the fiscal framework. So I'm just going to put on the record the one question on that particular issue, which was that the fiscal framework has helped us through COVID-19 and indeed the early months of Brexit. But what weaknesses have been identified in the fiscal framework and how can it be improved and made more flexible? And what engagement has there been with the UK government on the scope of the review and when it will commence?
Well, I think the predecessor Finance Committee was very helpful in this regard with their report on the fiscal framework, which I know was supported on a cross-party basis. And it identified some of the benefits of the fiscal framework, particularly during a year or two of volatility, but also identified some of the shortcomings. And we obviously are due to work with the UK government to commission an independent report of the fiscal framework. I am very keen that that report captures all the points that the predecessor Finance Committee highlighted, that independent stakeholders have highlighted, like the Fraser Valander, and in no particular order. It demonstrates that the arbitrary caps on borrowing for both the forecast error as well as spend are not keeping pace with inflation or the size of the budget or indeed the potential size of the forecast error. It secondly suggests that our ability to carry forward and manage budget across years is limited. And then thirdly, I think the challenge is when it comes to managing the levels of volatility and risk, that we should consider some additional levers to help the Scottish Government manage it. I know it's a very technical area, and I'd be very grateful for the Finance Committee to continue to consider what it believes should be done on the fiscal framework. I certainly think that we shouldn't make the review or the report so narrow that we aren't cognisant of what the pandemic has taught us about the operation of Scottish Government finances.
Thank you for that. I'm going to open up now to colleagues around the table, and the first person to ask questions will be Liz.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just take you back to the programme for government, which you mentioned earlier when the convener was questioning some issues? One of the other things that you said in your speech about the programme for government in terms of trying to encourage economic growth was that it's the Scottish Government's mission, and I quote, to create the best conditions for entrepreneurs to see the opportunities to increase production, increase innovation and create jobs. So can I just ask you, in light of the statistics that you've obviously seen from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and I'm sure in light of the advice that you've had from your new Council of Economic Advisers, who I think is that July to the autumn, that they're providing some evidence, can I just ask you, without obviously you're not going to tell us the detail of the budget, I wouldn't expect that, but could you tell us where they are trying to focus your attention on the priorities for that economic growth?
Thanks. I think in a number of different points, the first is a real focus on innovation leading to productivity. Now, you will be mindful of this, and we've heard a lot about productivity challenges in the media over the last few days that are UK-wide. But we have a real challenge when it comes to increasing levels of productivity. And those are being highlighted by the population shortages right now. So if we are going to be living in an environment where we are unable to access additional labour from out with the country, then it's even more imperative that we are investing in innovation, we're investing in tech, and we are improving productivity levels across the country. That's been a point repeated for a number of years by the CBI and others. So a focus on how we incentivise innovation and invest in productivity, and that includes investing in our people. Which takes me to the second point, which is a real focus on skills, making sure that we have the right skills in the right places for the right jobs. Now, we have seen post-pandemic, not that we're through the pandemic, that unemployment is much lower than originally forecast. But it does mean that there are acute labour shortages in certain sectors. So we need to make sure that through the Young Persons Guarantee and our other interventions like the National Transition Training Fund, that we are reskilling people with the right skills that are actually required. And so those would be two areas that are coming through loud and clear of the conversations we're having around the Advisory Council that I'm hearing regularly from business organisations and that I would like to see prioritised in the forthcoming budget.
Okay, that's very helpful indeed. Just in terms of the reskilling issue, I mean, I've heard people like Sandy Begbie talking very much about the Young Persons Guarantee and working from the perspective that many young people have particular issues at this time. But there are many other issues about reskilling people who have been in the economy in a job and perhaps who are still on furlough, not actually going back to the job that, you know, was there before the pandemic. Can I press you a little bit on what priorities you feel need to be taking our attention when it comes to upskilling those who will probably find it very difficult to get back into the labour force?
Yeah, I think that's a very fair point. That whilst interventions in amongst young people are important, some of the real challenges are with those either facing redundancy because their industries are changing or because or they have been made redundant. And that is where the National Transition Training Fund really comes in, because what it is trying to do is to provide funding within particular sectors to help their people transition. So, for example, if I take you back to the tourism recovery plan, so bear in mind that was the response to recommendations as established by the Tourism Recovery Task Force, which was predominantly industry leaders. They asked very specifically for the need for help for reskilling and up and retraining. And so an element of the National Transition Training Fund has gone specifically to help the tourism industry and the hospitality industry reskill, upskill their staff. They're obviously facing labour market shortages, so it's really important that they have the right skills there. Then when it comes, though, for people who are moving between sectors, so it's not a case of upskilling within their sector, but between sectors, we also have support in place and perhaps need to review that support and make sure it's fit for purpose as we progress through the pandemic, but support it to help people, to help take people from where they are just now to where they want to be. The most obvious example of that would be, I suggest, in oil and gas, where not through decisions made by governments in this country, but through the global reduction in demand for oil and gas, people have unfortunately faced redundancy and providing support for them. So I think it's within industries and then across industries that support needs to be made available. And we do obviously, the last point I'll make before I stop, is we do obviously through PACE, which is the wraparound support available to employees facing redundancy, have a very specific and targeted training available to help. But it is a huge challenge to try and equip people with the skills that they need to either transition to a new job or a different job in their own industry.
Thank you. I have a couple more questions, Cabinet Secretary, if I may. Firstly, just taking you back to, you mentioned the tourist sector there. I'm being told by a lot of tourism bodies in Perthshire particularly, that they feel that they, it's difficult to get people to take up jobs that are there because they don't actually want the jobs. And that is slightly different from not having the right skills. And I just wonder what the Scottish Government is doing to address this problem of a latent workforce out there, because if you look at the statistics for employment and unemployment, there are people out there, but in many cases, they don't actually want to have the particular jobs that are on offer, and that's different from the skills agenda. So can I ask you what the Scottish Government's doing about that problem?
Yes, thanks very much. And it's a really difficult problem to solve, because you quite clearly can't force people into particular occupations. I think what we can do, though, and there was a real focus on this in the Tourism Recovery Task Force's work, there was a real focus on how to make these jobs more attractive. So I previously referenced some of the short-term urgent work we did with the tourism industry, which was to specifically try and help recruit to these roles, so to present it as an attractive industry to work in, and we were happy to do that. But I think a lot of the Tourism Recovery Task Force's work was looking at how to make it a more attractive career option. So rather than just assuming it's a filler job until you get something else, how do you make it more attractive? And the Tourism Recovery Task Force, again, predominantly industry-based, had a number of suggestions for how to do that, and we've provided initial support, particularly around the skills and training. And bear in mind, it's not, I know I'm talking about skills and training, but it's also part of the attractive package within the tourism industry, where you feel like you're being invested in and therefore hopefully have more of a sense of loyalty and responsibility to the job. But I think terms and conditions go alongside that. Pay goes alongside that as well. Trying to ensure that the living wage is being paid is one small example. So I think it's a huge area, and where we can provide support, we will, whether that's financial support or working with the industry to implement their recommendations. But this work is very much being industry-led, and I think that's important.
Thank you again. My last question is very much about tax revenues. And obviously, we've heard from many witnesses before this committee that there are demographic issues in terms of Scotland's ageing population, therefore working population being squeezed. Can I ask you, in terms of the overall perspective of the budget, where do you see, from a Scottish perspective, where you think there is the greatest possibility of raising tax revenues, which in turn would obviously help in terms of government spending?
I think there's two parts to that. Firstly, we need a growing economy to ensure that there are tax revenues. So I am a firm believer in the notion that if businesses are doing well, they are trading well, and they are paying their taxes, then we have a secure source of revenue. And that was the reason why we extended non-domestic rates relief for a full year. we could have implemented non-domestic rates perhaps halfway through the year when signs of recovery were obvious. I wanted to extend it to a full year to maximise the time for industry to recover. And we will be very cognizant of that as we go into the budget. How do we ensure that our taxation enables businesses to fully recover, fully trade? And clearly, since the pandemic, there have been other challenges facing business, not least the shortages, which perhaps have hindered their ability to trade fully. So that would be the first point. Now, the second point is to continue to use the mix of tax that we have. We obviously have a limited income tax. We have non-domestic rates, which is often used, considered as the primary business tax, although it is a property tax. And they don't allow for much room for manoeuvre, to be honest. So from that perspective, we know too that it's our relative performance to the rest of the UK that really matters when it comes to income tax. So on both of those taxes, I don't see huge room for manoeuvre just now, not least because we don't have allowances, we don't have incentives when it comes to income tax, and we've got to be mindful of how it interacts, for example, with national insurance contributions and on non-domestic rates, because it's a property tax, not really a business tax. So economic growth would be my first answer, and my second answer is there isn't a huge room for manoeuvre on tax policy.
Okay, thank you.
John, to be followed by Ross.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, there's just so many areas here, but to take up something that's been mentioned before would be inflation. And we had a bit of a discussion with our advisers previously about what is short-term inflation, just because people had savings and they've all rushed out and bought the same kind of car, and so there's a shortage of cars and the price goes up. But presumably that will come down. But other things like maybe the gas price could be staying higher for longer. And the whole thing with wages, if we're short of staff, does that inevitably lead to inflation? And therefore, what impact would that have on Scotland and the Scottish budget? Because presumably, if the hospitals or the hotels, sorry, and the shops all start paying more wages, we'd have to pay nurses and everybody else more wages. So have you any thoughts about inflation as to whether, do you feel it is a major problem or is it quite minor?
No, it is a very significant consideration in our budgeting. You've mentioned a number of ways in which it has an impact on our budget. Perhaps the most obvious one is when it comes to pay, because quite clearly a significant percentage of our budget is spent on people. So on staff in our NHS, on local government staff, on public bodies, and that means that public sector pay is quite an important element of our budget setting, and certainly it's been a big focus of previous budgets. And you've got to be mindful of inflation when it comes to public sector pay policy. There are obviously other implications as well when it comes to inflation, but I suppose in short, as you will know, it has an impact on costs, and therefore to achieve our policy aims or to build the infrastructure we want to build, we can't escape the impact of inflation. I wonder whether it's an area, without putting him on the spot, that Dougie might want to come in on, if you would like to hear from him.
Yeah, not too much to add. I suppose, you know, clearly we and others look very closely at the Bank of England's outlook, and they have been projecting that CPI inflation will rise to at least 4% by the end of this calendar year and continue into the new year. And just in the context of public sector pay, this is clearly a time where almost all workforces will be looking to renegotiate new deals that are fair, sustainable and affordable. So with the devolved public sector pay bill being such a significant part of the Scottish Government's resource budget, that is clearly a a really, really important issue for this budget. And last point is that we'll wait and see what, if anything, the Chancellor says later this month on their underlying public sector pay assumptions for their spending review. They might say very little, and we might get some insights, and we will ask, but the way that the Whitehall Department's pay remit cycle tends to go is that they tend to negotiate their respective pay deals a bit later in the year than we do, and we kind of have to go first with the settlement that we have. So we'll be watching that very, very closely. Thanks.
Okay, well, thanks both very much for that. If I can move on to a different subject, that would be capital expenditure and borrowing. Now, the Fiscal Framework Outturn report shows that we are increasingly nearing our limit on borrowing, which I think is £3 billion, and the forecast is that it would be 82% by the end of 2023-24. So I just wonder if that's going to cause us problems. I mean, assuming the fiscal framework doesn't get revised, which is a separate question, but if we are going to hit this limit, what happens then?
Well, I suppose the short answer is that we won't if we continue on the trajectory that was set out in the medium-term financial strategy, because we can't. We have to allow for headroom. We obviously have to manage our budget in a way that allows for unforeseen circumstances. And the medium-term financial strategy set out our approach to borrowing. And clearly, the next medium-term financial strategy will set that out as well. But that doesn't mean to say that we couldn't use additional borrowing powers if the cap was higher. We, I believe, that our borrowing powers should more be in line with what local government has around borrowing powers, which is based on affordability rather than on arbitrary caps, because arbitrary caps don't take into account the changing nature of the challenges, the economic imperatives to invest or to not invest, and local government's prudential borrowing scheme is based on affordability rather than on arbitrary caps. So I do think it's an argument for something that is more akin to what local government has than on arbitrary caps.
Well, that's certainly something I'm very much in favour of, the prudential framework as well. I mean, have we any indication from Westminster if that's the kind of thing that they would be willing to discuss when the fiscal framework is reviewed?
I'm certainly hoping to discuss it. We're not getting a huge appetite, as it were, for change. I've certainly not had much evidence of an appetite for change during the pandemic when we looked for temporary fiscal flexibilities. So I think it's unlikely, but I do think there's an opportunity for Civic Scotland, if I could say it like that, on a cross-party basis to come to a position on borrowing, which is actually good for Scottish businesses and the Scottish economy, and isn't new because local government already has it. I should say that obviously the Scottish Fiscal Commission has to judge our projections of capital borrowing, and their most recent report said that they thought that our capital projections were reasonable.
Thanks again very much for that. To move to a different part of the Fiscal Framework Outturn report, Social Security. If I'm understanding the figures correctly, some of it is quite complex, I confess. The forecast in the 2020 budget was expenditure of £3.212 billion. The outturn was £3.262 billion, which is £49 million more. I mean, I'm just wondering, is Social Security so early on that we can't really say what's happening with it? There's been a lot of changes. Some things we didn't take on quite as quickly as I think we'd hoped. COVID must have had an impact. Or do you think we are going to struggle going forward to stay within our budget on Social Security?
I think the discussions about the fiscal framework have often focused on the volatility inherent in tax forecasts. And perhaps we focus less on the inherent volatilities in Social Security demand. But I think there are two reasons for forecast error when it comes to Social Security. One is that we've been through quite an uncertain 18 months with COVID. So it would make sense that getting a grasp of what demand truly is has been challenging. But secondly, it's likely, and I think the SFC's forecast illustrated this as well, that demand for Social Security is going to increase. And that, again, bearing in mind that revenue borrowing for forecast error is capped, obviously, £300 million, that it needs to cover not only tax volatility, but also Social Security volatility. And because it's a demand-led budget, we must fund it. We have an obligation to fund it. So there's two challenges. One is that from a fixed budget, I have got to fund what is quite a significant demand-led budget line. And that secondly, when there's errors in the forecast, the limits on our revenue borrowing for forecast error are quite low. So it is an area of concern in ensuring that we can continue to meet that demand lab, which we are obliged to do and which we must do. But at the second point is, if we don't have any capacity in the revenue borrowing limits, then obviously we have to fund that forecast error from within our budget.
Yeah, I think there's quite a lot in there. We could explore that further, but I'll move on just because I've got one other point I wanted to raise, which was the recent national insurance increase at Westminster level, or I believe it's called the Health and Social Care Levy, or will be called that. Are we clear now as to exactly what Scotland's going to be getting from that, or how that's going to work for us?
Yes and no. So I wrote to the UK government in the immediate aftermath of the announcement on the Health and Social Care Levy to seek just some clarity on various points. I must confess that the answer I got didn't give me any of those answers. The big question for us remain, what will we get in additional consequentials? So in the past, when there have been announcements about increased spend in health and social care, which have generated consequentials, we have later on discovered that actually it's netted off funding that was due to come anyway. So it's not actually all additional. So we have what the UK government has publicly announced for Scotland, that the big question on the 27th of October is, will that all be additional, or will actually some of it be netted off decreases in other health and social care lines? So it's not, for example, a net additional £1 billion.
Okay, that's great. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much. Ross, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. I was keen to discuss with you the effect of the arbitrary cash terms limits on the fiscal framework, but I think you've covered that with Mr. Mason. So moving on to the issue of non-domestic rates, which you touched on in your answer to Liz Smith, I think the total value of non-domestic rates relief through the various schemes that are on offer in Scotland comes to something in the region of £700 million now. And that was expanded during the pandemic, for example, to the newspaper industry. For obvious reasons, I think that was an issue that was twice unanimously supported by Parliament. Given the range, though, of options for non-domestic rates relief, what evaluation has the government done on the effectiveness of those various schemes?
So it's a very good question. We have commissioned work from the Fraser Valander to review the effectiveness of the Small Business Bonus Scheme in particular, and that work is ongoing to review how effective it is in meeting its policy objective, which is obviously to help small businesses and has a huge role to play, particularly in local economies and on our high street. So that would be the primary review that's ongoing. But quite clearly, we are asked on a regular basis for additional reliefs. And we have reliefs in place for hydro. We have reliefs in place for new buildings, recently occupied buildings. And all of them have to be reviewed on their own terms. So, for example, the Business Growth Accelerator, which enables, well, incentivises new builds, or the Fresh Start Scheme, which incentivises tenants to occupy previously unoccupied buildings, need to be reviewed on their own merits. And we do every budget period consider again whether that is the best use for our limited funds, or whether there's another way to meet those policy aims, which I think we would all agree on, through other use of the funding. And that regular review is really important.
Thank you. Can I just check when the Fraser-Vounder review is due to report?
It's a good question. I may have to write to you. It was due a number of months ago, but was delayed because of COVID, in that we wanted to make sure that the reviewers were getting access to small businesses and ensuring that they had comprehensive data. And I don't know if any of my officials know when we have confirmed an updated timetable. But if not, I'll come back to you in writing on what the latest deadline is.
Not seen.
I think I'll come back to you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. That's appreciated. You mentioned the regular requests that are made for additional rates relief, which is absolutely the case. But recently there have been more requests than I'd noticed in previous years for additional conditions to be placed on rates relief. So, for example, in the SDUC's evidence to this committee, they've proposed conditions around fair work, living wage, etc. I think Alcohol Focus Scotland have proposed a public health condition that's levied against licensed premises. Without commenting on any of the specific proposals that have been made, although you're of course welcome to if you wish to, does the government have a position, do you have any comment to make on the principle of additional conditionality on rates relief, particularly given the challenging fiscal situation that we're looking at overall in the coming years?
So let me answer that in two parts. One is that I am very supportive of the principle of conditionality across all government spend. So I think that we should look more carefully, and we've committed to doing so as part of the cooperation agreement, to consider where we can embed conditionality in a proportionate fashion. But the second part is perhaps more disappointing, which is I have looked at non-domestic rates through every lens for how we can expand conditionality, and it is extremely challenging, if not impossible, in places. And I think we put a huge burden on non-domestic rates, which, bear in mind, is a property tax, because we don't actually have any other form of business taxation in Scotland. So non-domestic rates, which is a property tax, it's not a business tax, it is very difficult to it's very difficult to use conditionality in non-domestic rates for any other reason than conditions related to the property itself. The non-domestic rates is based entirely on the rental value of a property, what that property might get in the open market, and then that's applied to the poundage. And therefore, non-domestic rates was never established to take into account income generation. It was never based on employees. So all these other conditions that you might want to attach to reliefs are almost impossible for a property tax. That's not to say that we haven't looked at this. And during the pandemic in particular, I was very keen to see if there was any other conditions we could attach. But right now, the methodology for non-domestic rates, the way in which it's collected, and the whole principle underlying non-domestic rates means that it's almost impossible to attach conditions that are not specifically related to the actual property. Now, people may argue, we'll overhaul non-domestic rates, set up a taxation regime that is based on income, it's based on other factors, and that's a perfectly legitimate argument to make. But because it's a property tax, I think we look to non-domestic rates to do more than it was ever set up to do, or that indeed it is capable of doing, because it is the only form of semi-business taxation that we have in Scotland.
Thank you. That's useful. Just one brief final question for myself, Convener. The second Coronavirus Act that Parliament passed last year included conditions around the awarding of COVID grants to businesses, COVID relief grants, specifically in relation to tax avoidance, which is timely this week given the Pandora Papers revelations. Now, accepting that that is a particularly challenging area to review the effectiveness of, because you would hope the net effect is such businesses wouldn't bother trying to apply in the first place, has any attempt been made at evaluating the impact of attaching a tax avoidance condition on government grants?
So, yes, in short, in that we, and in indeed to non-domestic rates as well, just to link in with your previous question, because the Barclay Review of Non-Domestic Rates specifically talked about what powers in Scotland we might have to crack down on tax avoidance. And that was incorporated, and again, happy to send the committee more information about non-domestic rates in relation to a general tax avoidance provision. But when it comes to our own, and you'll remember when it came to the discussion about tax havens, there was a lot of public debate as to whether the Scottish Government actually had the powers to do it or not. So where we have powers or where we have softer means of crackdown and tax avoidance, we will, but they are ultimately reserved. So when it comes to having real teeth to crack down on tax avoidance, those powers are still reserved to the UK government.
Thank you.
Thank you. And it's Douglas to be followed by Michelle.
Good convener and morning, Cabinet Secretary. I was pleased to hear you mention earlier about potential increased flexibilities for local government when it comes to raising revenue. Just wondering if you could maybe expand a little bit more on when we might see that. Would that be part of the budget setting process, or would that be part of the local government fiscal framework that I think is still in development? And could one of those flexibilities be the removal of the council tax 3% cap?
So I think your question highlights that there are some areas which can be actioned in budgets from year to year. So you talked about council tax. But then a fuller conversation about the right mix of powers and flexibilities, I think, are rightly for the fiscal framework discussions in collaboration with COSLA. Now, they've not moved perhaps at the speed that either party would have liked, largely due to COVID, but I'm certainly committed to getting them back on track. And in terms of council tax, obviously, our position on council tax specifically will be set out in this upcoming budget. But I can absolutely assure you that that budget will only be set after extensive consultation with COSLA's finance spokesperson, Gail McGregor.
So could I maybe just pick a little bit more then on the sort of back to the timetable, because it was something that, you know, I'd raised COSLA a couple of years ago and it still hasn't progressed. So just, you know, to get your opinion when you might think that might come back to be approved by the Scottish Government and COSLA.
Yeah, I think because it's because there's two parties involved, and you'll be conscious that there is quite a lot of change afoot for local government over the next year. I think we could make some progress prior to the local government elections, but I imagine that it will be one of the first areas to pick up post local government election. We are absolutely committed to undertaking the work with COSLA to develop that rules-based fiscal framework to support future funding settlements. I think the other part to this, which again is not a cop-out, but one of the big asks I think that local government want and need is this ability to set multi-year budgets. So along with the additional flexibilities is the ability to know actually what's in a budget from year to year. And I would sincerely hope that the resource spending review, which we will set out, will allow local government to look 3 years ahead from year to year.
Sorry, we seem to have lost the Cabinet Secretary there. You back, Kate?
Sorry, I didn't quite catch that. I didn't quite catch that, I'm afraid.
Yeah. Can we have a...
No, sorry, Cabinet Secretary, you broke up there. But
right, I don't know if it's just me or whether those others, but I'm struggling to hear the committee.
Okay, I'll try moving on anyway. In the framework outturn report, it talks about air passenger duty, and there was obviously a consultation done between March and June. It was really just to get some idea when that may progress or not.
Yeah, so you'll recall that air passenger duty was we're all set to devolve it when we discovered a pretty major issue around subsidy control in relation to the Highlands and Islands air discount scheme and the exemption there. Now, we were in extensive conversation with the UK government as to where that would sit and couldn't expose our finances to the potential liability if before that issue was resolved. Now, it had to be resolved with the EU. So clearly in the last 6 to 9 months, that fundamental issue has slightly moved because of Brexit. And in terms of progress, I think it will be something that we want to progress as part of the discussions about the fiscal framework. But ultimately, the challenge was to do with the Highlands and Islands exemption and the need to resolve that before air passenger duty was devolved.
I guess the answer is then it will be part of the next fiscal framework and dealt with in that.
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, it doesn't need to wait for that. So conversations continue with the UK government. We are still committed, fully committed to devolving it. I think the two issues would be, first of all, we were making quite good progress on trying to resolve the Highlands and Islands exemption, and then not to keep using COVID as an excuse, but COVID did strike. So I think a lot of these areas which were being progressed at pace prior to COVID are now being picked up on. But because we've got a wider conversation about the fiscal framework, it makes sense to have those conversations in that context.
Thank you. Next question I had was, we've had many witnesses come to committee and tell us that, to meet our ambitious net zero targets that we've set will require a huge amount of investment. So I guess, would it just come out in the budget about, other commitments that are already in place, would some of them have to be removed to meet this new commitment?
Well, thankfully, when it comes to our commitments to net zero, there are two areas which are already highly visible. One is the capital spending review. So that was completed last year and published alongside the infrastructure investment plan. And that gives the long-term multi-year view of investment in infrastructure. And I think one of the, I don't know if this came through in your committee evidence or not, but one of the primary drivers of when it comes to that shift to net zero will be investment in low carbon infrastructure. So we talk at length about the need for a transition in transport, but that requires public sector and private sector investment in transport systems. The same with heating and power. So that capital spending review stands prior to this budget, and the budget will action the next year in that capital spending review when it comes to investment in low carbon infrastructure. And that was accompanied by a £2 billion low carbon fund to try and accelerate investment in low carbon infrastructure. But the next thing, obviously, is the Programme for Government and the Green Cooperation Agreement, which again is quite clear about where we need to make those shifts. And again, the budget is just actually the power behind the Programme for Government. So it enacts the Programme for Government with real money out of a challenging settlement.
We see like commitments like the duelling of the A96, for example, having to give way to meet these other new commitments.
No.
Okay.
No. As a Highlander and who knows how important these roads are and who drives up and down that A9 far too often to count, I think it's really important that we continue to invest in Highland and Northern and North East communities.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Followed by Daniel.
Hello there. Just perhaps following up from one of the themes that Ross was following up around tax avoidance. My understanding is that the historical dispute that goes back to the further devolution concerning proceeds of crime, that the 30 million figure that was originally assumed to be remain with the Scottish Government and now is assumed by the UK Government to go back to them, resulting in a dispute. Is that still the case? And what further insights can you give as to any discussions you've had with the UK Government around that issue? And can I further confirm that even if you invested in terms of moving resources from Police Scotland into finding more financial crime, none of the benefit of that would accrue to the Scottish Government budget? So this is me just clarifying my understanding.
So you're right that this is primarily a justice issue, and that ultimately when it comes to policing these issues, the responsibility does lie with HMRC and Companies House, obviously, which are reserved under UK government competence. Obviously, Police Scotland have a role when it comes to any suspected criminality, but on funding itself, where it is a reserved matter, it will be funded on a UK-wide basis rather than consequential funding being generated for the Scottish Government. But come back to me if I've misunderstood any element of your question.
I suppose the point I'm trying to make is that given the dispute that's in place at the moment around no detriment, that were the Scottish Government to discover more crime, even if it were able to, which as many areas it's not able to, it wouldn't get the benefit of that increased funding from proceeds of crime, because it would all be offset in terms of the overall budget. I'm just clarifying, is my understanding correct?
Yeah, I mean, we currently believe that when it comes to the application of block grant adjustments for the Proceeds of Crime Act, revenues of £4 million per annum, it breaches the Smith Commission no detriment principle. And that is because we think that funding should come to the Scottish Government. But in terms of how we're going to resolve it, I previously wrote to the Chief Secretary for the Treasury to try and progress a resolution of that issue. And we have agreed that it should be resolved as part of the fiscal framework review. So it's still an outstanding issue. And it's obviously quite a highly technical area. And I wonder whether Claire McManus wants to come in with any further information that I've missed out.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think you've covered everything. As the member mentioned, there's prior to the fiscal framework agreement, there was a 30 million cap on these revenues, which was never breached. So that is the basis of the current dispute. And as you've mentioned, both governments, you've agreed with the CST to consider this as part of the fiscal framework review.
Okay. And off that, just following on from that and perhaps picking up what Ross was talking about in terms of tax avoidance, it's not just tax avoidance, it's unintended consequences. We know that there are huge issues with the likes of mini umbrella companies, particularly we've seen coming off the back of the COVID pandemic. We know there's huge issues with Scottish limited partnerships being used for money laundering. My understanding is that none of those areas reside under something that the Scottish Government can do, even though clearly if you take an international perspective, it affects our international brand as a place to do business if people can freely use very loose arrangements such as Scottish limited partnerships. Can you confirm my understanding is correct? And also whether there might be other vehicles, even in the form of soft power, to use, say, around things like Scottish Limited Partnerships, where the Law Society of Scotland, for example. I appreciate this is straying into justice, so you might want to decline answering that, but just to give a sense of that, if you could.
Yeah, I mean, in short, your characterisation is accurate. we have, where we can, used softer powers to try and crack down on tax avoidance. And actually, I would say that what we've seen from Revenue Scotland since it was established is a really firm and effective approach to tax avoidance, because they're working collaboratively with other public bodies, for example, SEPA, when it comes to landfill. Now, those taxes are small in the grand scheme of things, although they are important for the Scottish Government. But I think we have seen from the beginning of Revenue Scotland's time and other devolved taxation that we have taken a much more robust approach to tax avoidance. But you're right in saying that that will only be based on soft powers rather than on actual legislation, because ultimately tax avoidance is a reserved matter.
And my last question then, in terms of the difference between accountability and responsibility, if you look at things like the National Performance Framework, the Scottish Government takes accountability for many of the outcomes and it's very outcome driven. But all the discussion today has been about the areas where the Scottish Government has responsibility and has no responsibility, despite having accountability for a whole range of areas. We've also got the reverse situation where the UK Government is accountable for many areas but is not responsible to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament in terms of scrutiny. So just for the record then, perhaps I can ask you a question. If you were to have a choice over those areas that responsibility was aligned with accountability, what top three areas would you pick, given the considerable challenges we have economically, which we've explored extensively today, near term and longer term? What would be the three things that you would like to put on the record?
I mean, it's a great question. I think from a technical perspective, being able to have a wider mix of tax powers would be far more effective in terms of both managing our budget and also managing the economy. So right now, when it comes to, for example, business support, we have just spent a number of minutes talking about non-domestic rates, despite the fact it's not a business tax, it's a property tax. So having a broader mix of tax powers, having obviously all the powers associated with income tax, as well as a wealth tax, perhaps capital gains, understanding the interactions and having responsibility over the interactions with things like national insurance contributions between that and income tax. So I think my first ask would be to have a far more comprehensive toolbox at our disposal when it comes to tax powers, so that we're not basing all our action on a few narrow taxes that actually can't bear the weight of what we're asking them to do. That's certainly true of income tax. And that position is pretty sort of universally shared amongst tax professionals. The second thing is to manage volatility and manage our budget from year to year. So this notion of having an arbitrary cap of £300 million purely for forecast error is hugely detrimental. It reduces our ability to plan ahead, and it also means that where there is forecast error that exceeds that £300 million, as we've seen in previous years, we have to use actual money that could otherwise be used for public services to deal with that forecast error. And so the ability to manage our budget in year and from year to year needs to be considered. And then the final point would just be a prudential borrowing scheme that is based on affordability. We already have to base capital borrowing decisions on affordability. You know, I have to deal with the revenue consequences of capital borrowing in future years. I know that. The medium-term financial strategy sets out how we're managing it. The notion that if we had borrowing powers, for some reason we wouldn't use it prudently, it doesn't bear up to scrutiny, because we've had to do that in part with capital borrowing. So all we're asking for actually is something similar to what local government has around prudential borrowing. And so those would be my three items on the wish list.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Daniel.
Thank you, Convener. And actually, in some ways, I'd like to pick up some of the points you were just touching on. I mean, I
I'm very interested in ensuring that we develop the fiscal framework and indeed the budget processes around block grant, because I believe that's the way that we strengthen the devolution settlement, and that's certainly my my overarching objective. But I was just wondering if I could just test some of your assumptions and assertions. I think, I mean, again, stepping through what you've just asked for there, I mean, the prudential borrowing, I think, you know, makes a bit of straightforward sense. But stepping back, the forecasts are, I mean, income tax revenues are approximately £12 billion to the Scottish Exchequer. Your ability to borrow against that forecast error is around £300 million. So that is about 2%. I mean, if I'm looking at the forecast errors in the recent forecasts, they have been a little bit less than that. So is that a real issue, or is it a notional one? And if it is real, could you give some examples of where you've essentially hit your headroom on that borrowing limit? Just I'm sort of bring the issue to life for me is what I'm asking.
Yeah, thanks. So just purely on that issue, bear in mind that forecast error, and I may ask officials to come in on this as well to give the straight bat technical answer. But our, you know, Scottish Fiscal Commission analysis shows that income tax reconciliations could exceed Scottish Government borrowing powers up to four times every 10 years. Now, that may not feel as tangible as you need it to do. Our own analysis suggests that there is up to a 1 in 6 chance that funding volatility as a result of income tax forecast error would breach the current limits of our resource borrowing powers. But you've got to also remember that those borrowing limits have also got to cover forecast error for other devolved taxes as well, and also for social security benefits. So you can't just look at income tax when it comes to forecast error. You know, governments around the world have got to manage their budgets within fiscal rules, and that's right and proper. But the difficulty for us is that we're dealing with a fixed budget. So we would still have to take a very prudent approach to how we spend our money. But what we're talking about here is the ability to use our spending power for public services rather than trying to resolve errors through no fault of our own from previous years. When it comes to this year, the reconciliation applying to the 2021-22 budget is higher than the current borrowing powers. So it is, from memory, although somebody can correct me, I think about £319 million. So that is higher than £300 million. It doesn't get more tangible than that. The only reason why it hasn't breached borrowing powers this year is because of a Scotland-specific shock due to a timing difference between our forecast and the UK government's forecast, allowing that resource borrowing limit to be increased on a temporary basis. So perhaps, if anything, this year's position demonstrates why it was essential that we did see the borrowing limit increase on a temporary basis, and that perhaps increase on a temporary basis should be made permanent. Does that give you enough of a tangible hook
I think I'd like to see the analysis. And it's not because I dispute the point. I mean, I understand the fundamental point. And I mean, it stands to reason that when your revenue is based on forecasting, any forecast is going to have a margin for error. And that essentially the borrowing power should be in line with what that margin of error is. I mean, that's sort of the fundamental point. I guess what I'm interested in is actually the hard analysis of the quantum of that and how far away the Scottish Government is saying that borrowing power actually is. I mean, just take it as read. I understand that having it as a hard nominal limit doesn't make sense to me. It's just a question of, you know, what order of magnitude should that be? But if I could move on, the associated point, and I think this is in a sense almost more important. Again, you were stating that one of the issues that has been faced over the last year is understanding once announcements have been made, actually, forgive the shorthand, you know, when you can bank them. And again, I recognise it's an exceptional year, but sometimes exceptions come along. But so two questions. First of all, how indicative of that is that of a general issue that you have in terms of funding coming through the block grant and the predictability you have? And again, what is the actual, what is the actual substance of that issue? Is it that simply the Scottish Government takes a very cautious approach and wants to see the ink dried on the bit of paper before it actually starts actioning that funding? Or is it actually that you don't know until the cash hits your bank account that you're definitely going to get it from the Treasury? And I'm guessing there's a range of possibilities in between those two points. And again, if you've got any specific examples of where that has caused a problem and actually the money has been less than you were anticipating, that would be quite useful to have on the record.
In short, we are not cautious when it comes to getting money out to the people and the services that need it as soon as we can. Where this issue has been really exacerbated during the year is because of the level of volatility. So again, just stating the basics, which you'll forgive me for, but to build up the argument, we can't overspend our budget. So at the end of the financial year, I have got to bring a budget to Parliament through the outturn statement, which does not overspend. And Treasury would not look kindly on us if we overspent. So in your budget management is all about trying to maximise the spending power for the services that need it, for to meet the asks. And, you know, every day in Parliament, there will probably be another ask for where we need to spend more money. So to maximise our spending power on where a budget is required, but at the same time to come in on budget. And the difficulty is during the year with volatility, if the UK government announces, let's take the most recent announcement of the health and social care spend. So it was, we were told it's up to £520 million. They will confirm that at the main estimates, which is probably going to be, the final confirmed position will be probably January, February, March. If all that £520 million is already spent on the important services that it needs to be spent on, and we will spend that, you know, it's not, don't read into what I'm saying is a lack of commitment to spending the money that needs to be spent. In January or February, we're told, actually, you're going to get £400 million in consequentials because the UK government equivalent departments haven't spent the full amount that would generate the full £520 million, or because it's recycled funding. I suddenly have a shortfall of £120 million, which I need to find with only a matter of weeks to go before the end of the financial year to ensure that our budget comes in on balance. And that's the level of risk. So knowing that that's going to be the position, we are managing our budget in year on a daily basis to try and maximise the spending power, whilst at the same time being cognisant that once it's spent, it's very challenging then to meet that shortfall. A real actual example was £25 million for education. So there was an announcement by the UK government of funding for education, which is very welcome. And we passed on that funding to education. And then at the May estimates, we discovered that actually the position on that funding was £25 million less. That means that's £25 million that I actually won't receive, but that I've already passed on. So it's not a complaint, it's just a request for more levers to manage that level of volatility to ensure that we do come in on balance. Last year, the Barnett Guarantee said, well, there won't be negative consequentials. We're not going to claw back what we've announced. That meant I had total reassurance that when 25 million was announced, that 25 million could be passed on without the fear that it may actually be less than that. That Barnett Guarantee has been taken away this year, and because the UK government's volatility is such that they can't actually predict with any degree of certainty what UK departments will actually spend. And that's where the increased volatility this year has made it very difficult. So we manage that volatility internally, but it does make it more challenging. And for any government in this role, I think there would be huge value in more tools to manage the volatility.
Thank you. And I guess any budget process is going to be, you know, there'll be volatility that's external and internal. But I guess one of the corollaries of what you're saying is that you would find it useful if the UK government was more transparent and predictable in terms of the way that it followed through on its spending. And I'm just wondering if that is correct, whether or not the same is true for the Scottish government. And just thinking about some of the recent comments made by Audit Scotland about transparency. I was in particular interested by some of the things that they said in their recent report about these matters, saying that budget revisions are managed across government, which means it is not always possible to establish the details of reprioritisations within directorates, which to my mind sounds a little bit like the situation that you were pointing to with the UK government. And I'm just wondering whether you think there is an issue there about the need to around tracking within budget changes within directorates, whether there's an opportunity to improve the systems that you have in place. Again, one of the suppositions that Audit Scotland was making was that the data's there, but you're not able to report on it. I'm just thinking both in terms of your relationship with the UK government, but also your own practice. Do you think there is scope along those lines to improve transparency and disciplines regarding budget reporting?
I'm certainly open to any suggestions, and we'll give this more thought, for how we can be more publicly transparent in the budget. I think what is required, though, is probably more of a mature debate about the realities of budgeting, because quite clearly a lot of our budget is demand-led. So we saw during, if you take some of the business support, where budgets were demand-led, and let's say, for example, we announced £50 million and only £40 million was spent because that exhausted demand, and there was accusations of underspending the budget. Well, actually, that is the nature of budgets, where it's demand-led. Sometimes a demand-led budget can exceed the budget that's allocated, and we've got to manage that. Sometimes it can be less than forecast. So budgets are a very movable feast, and budget revisions, which are usually twice a year, with the exception of COVID when it was three times a year, is just a snapshot in time. It's a snapshot in time, and therefore it requires as much certainty as possible when we publicly publish that. So, you know, reflecting just finally before I stop on your point around the UK government, I'm actually quite sympathetic to the UK government's position, which is you can't say to the penny how much you're definitely going to spend over a year at the beginning of a year, or even at any point in a year, because who knows what might happen. You know, fuel shortages might happen, or there are other decisions that you need to respond to. So budgets are always going to be slightly movable feasts. I think my difficulty is not the nature of the movable feast. It's that because it's a fixed budget that must balance, it therefore means that you're managing a very, 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 very volatile situation with very limited levers. But to go back to your question, if there's more that we can do around transparency, I'm open to that. You know, if there's more transparency we can build into the budget revision process, then I'm open to that. And I know you'll be taking scrutiny, you'll scrutinise it in the coming weeks. So perhaps there's some feedback from what you will scrutinise that could inform future budget revisions.
I mean, I guess just follow up on that before I ask my final question. I guess what I'm speculating is whether or not both the UK government and the Scottish government, whether a kind of more robust and regular and detailed reporting on budget and spend through the year might actually help matters, along with I totally accept that much of government is demand-led, and you can't absolutely guarantee that you're going to spend a certain amount. But certainly what helps you manage a situation is by having robust reporting and tracking. And you know, certainly that's true in the private sector. You know, when your business is being dictated by whether or not customers spend money with you, that's much less predictable than anything government does, I would suggest. But so it's just a question of whether or not that is an avenue for improving things, both for both governments. But anyway, that's just sort of explaining where I'm coming from on that. My final question comes back to, I think, some of the questions we've been having in recent weeks about outcome-led budgeting and kind of really thinking about where we are 10 years on from Christie. And given that the medium-term financial plan is being developed and being published, I wondered if that is an opportunity to recast, you know, what the government is intending to do in the medium term around those outcomes and objectives. I think given that much of the commentary we've been receiving, both in terms of written and in terms of oral evidence, has been that essentially, unless you bake those objectives into the way that the government both budgets and indeed organises itself, you're essentially only sort of providing commentary really rather than driving change towards those objectives. So I was just wondering, is that going to be your approach? And is there more that can be done both in the MTFS but beyond it to actually bake those objectives into the way government budgets and indeed organises itself?
Yeah, so in short, if I were to summarise what you're saying, it is that our budget choices need to be aligned to the national performance framework. And that will require sometimes difficult decisions as to where we actually put the money, so that, for example, the big debate about preventative spend, putting more investment upstream to change the outcomes is important. Certainly, I think there's an opportunity to do this with the resource spending review in quite a significant way, because that will be multi-year. And I think most of the outcomes we're talking about won't be delivered in the space of a year. You know, changing health and social outcomes, for example, is a multi-year initiative. And the resource spending review allows us to do that, of looking at how the compounding effect of multiple years actually delivers that change. But I guess the challenge I'd put back, and I can't recall if I did it at this committee or the local government committee, the challenge I would put back is that the nature of our debate in the Parliament needs to reflect the magnitude of these choices. So, for example, if you are to spend more money in active travel, it's got to come from somewhere. So if you're trying to recycle money from, say, acute healthcare to active travel, I'm just using that as an example, then we've got to have a mature debate. Opposition has got to scrutinise in this fashion, and the government has got to present in this fashion a more mature debate about where that penny is best spent. There aren't unlimited supplies of funding, which I know we all know. And if we think it is important to invest in prevention rather than in cure, then that will require money to be shifted. And every time I stand up to present a budget which displays any reductions at all, those are immediately latched onto and criticised. So I think we need a mature debate. We certainly need to be pushed, as it were, by the opposition to contend with these issues. And I think the opposition needs to reflect that too.
Well, I think that might be why I was asking questions about medium-term spending plans. So just gently conclude there.
Thank you very much for that. I mean, disinvestment's always the key issue in terms of prevention, and we'll be certainly looking at that in the months ahead. Just some short questions from me, Cabinet Secretary, to finish off. And one is with regard to the fiscal framework. We've obviously touched a lot on issues in relation to borrowing, etc. And 5 years ago, when the fiscal framework was agreed at the 11th hour, the budgets were actually set in stone in terms of that, the limits were set in stone. And since then, there's been a 9.2% erosion in terms of inflation. So one of the asks, I take it, in terms of the review from the Scottish Government, is that any limits that are set should be index-linked to inflation. Would I be right?
At the very least, but basing limits on affordability rather than arbitrary caps would be my default position.
Indeed, thanks very much. Now, we talked about demographics and we talked about skills and we talked about jobs, but while the Scottish Government's got a young person's guarantee and facing a reduction of 60,000 workers in the 16 to 64 age group between 2020 and 2026, What is the Scottish Government do to focus on, for example, the 55 to 67-year-old age group who have a lot of skills, a lot of experience, many of them are very reliable, and how will the Scottish Government work to try and get some of those people back into the workforce or indeed retrain?
I think the primary means, but not the only means, is the National Transition Training Fund. And that is supporting those who are unemployed, at risk of redundancy, or who need to upskill or retrain. So that would be the primary means, I think, of reaching that age group. There is other schemes. So the No One Left Behind is about trying to support people who are furthest from the job market, for a whole host of reasons that you can that we could go into, to help them into work. So there are a number of different schemes, but the one I point you to is the National Transition Training Fund.
Okay, thank you. And finally for me, national insurance will impact on the public sector in Scotland to the tune of around £151 million, with £67 million national insurance on the NHS and £31 million on local government. And the UK government, I believe, is going to guarantee that. Have you had any guarantees that these consequentials of £151 million will come through? And also, can you advise what impact you feel that the national insurance levy will have on the private sector in terms of economic growth and jobs growth in Scotland?
Well, on the guarantee, the UK government's obviously announced what it believes will be generated and therefore what will come in consequentials. But where I would encourage the committee to scrutinise what's finally announced is to make sure that that, let's say, a billion, if it is a billion, is all additional and it's not netted off elsewhere. And that remains my concern. We will not know that until the 27th of October. I mean, it's been well documented that in terms of the impact on the private and the public sector employers, it will have an impact of that. There is no doubt as any increase in taxation will. And I think our job is to make sure that the money is used as wisely and as carefully. So, that would be my answer. But convener, not to go back, I promised an update on the small business bonus scheme in relation to Ross Greer's question. Dougie McLaren has said he's happy to answer that question now to save on a letter, but it's entirely at your discretion.
Yeah, OK, once I've finished this question, because I think what I was actually asking wasn't about the money for the that the levy is being raised towards, i.e., you know, it's spending on health and social care, but the impact that the national insurance levy will have on local government, for example, which collectively will raise some will have to pay £31 million towards the Treasury. And my understanding is that the UK government have agreed that, certainly in terms of south of the border, that they will provide the consequentials for that. Has that been guaranteed for Scotland so that, for example, the money that's allocated out of the billion you talked about, some of that does not then have to be fired back into local government, police, fire services, etc.? That's what I was trying to get at. So apologies if I didn't explain that clearly enough early on.
No, it was definitely my apology for not grasping that. Can I ask Dougie to come in? Because we've had quite a lot of engagement with the UK government on these points, and he might be able to give a brief update on whether or not there will be full compensation. Dougie.
Thanks. So yes, it's about compensation for public sector employer contribution increases, as you allude to, convener. And we've not had the assurance yet, and we are trying to test this with Treasury. And really, their kind of prevailing answer to all our questions around this is that we'll get the detail and the update at their spending review later this month. So, I mean, as things stand, it looks like what would come through would be a consequential funding increase related to the spend in the Westminster budgets, but the question for us will be: does that truly compensate, you know, in the UK government's you know, parlance, the need across public sector employers in Scotland? So we don't have quite the assurance or the detail on that yet, but we'll be testing it with the Treasury.
Thank you. And the second part of my question was, in terms of the national insurance increase, what is the implications for the economic growth and indeed employment growth in Scotland? What will be the impact?
I think we're still trying to fully comprehend what the impact will be, particularly on economic growth. A lot of our attention has focused on the impact of employees rather than the employers. But quite clearly, if you take, let's take a hotel on the Isle of Skye, who's most recently been in the press over the weekend, who is lamenting the fact that VAT is increasing, the fact that they can't secure labour, that prices are increasing across the supply chain. This is another issue for them to contend with, on top of quite a number of pressures that they're already facing.
They're all inflationary. Would you now like to answer the question that you were going to answer with regard to Ross?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I was just sort of checking my notes on this. So the Barclay Review, I think, asked for the Small Business Bonus Scheme review to be concluded by 2022. And as the Cabinet Secretary said, COVID interrupted. And I think some of the practical problem is that the Fraser of Allender need physical access on the university premises and some of their materials. I think that work's picking back up again, but we don't have an exact ETA. And if there's anything more to add that I find out from colleagues or from Fraser of Allender themselves, I'm happy to update the committee. Thank you.
OK, well, thank you very much for that, and that has exhausted our questions for this morning. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for answering so many questions so comprehensively. I'd also like to wish her a speedy recovery and also apologise for some of the glitches in broadcasting that we had this morning. The Cabinet Secretary valiantly managed to get through those, and we were able to ask the questions we wished to ask. So without any further ado, I'd like to end this public session of the committee. I will now have a 5-minute break, and then we'll go back into private session.